Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Strange and Obscure Stories of the Revolutionary War by Tim Rowland. Narrated by David Colacci. Preface. Perhaps because of the complexities of modern war, it's fashionable, maybe even comforting, to oversimplify the American Revolution. Yet the Revolution was every inch the sort of geopolitical calliope that we try to make sense of today. Today's Middle East has nothing on 18th-century Europe and its colonies for violence, atrocities, intrigue, and thorny alliances, where a thicket of ancient hatreds and grudges were virtually impossible to decipher. Many residents of Britain would have had no clue what it was that those hotheads in America were trying to prove. By their thinking, the colonists had it pretty sweet, allowed for the most part to pursue their own interests with little responsibility to the parent country under whose protection they operated. Many colonists themselves wondered the same thing, even if they felt no particular love for the crown, rolling their eyes at the gas bags in the cities with their gibberish about liberty, death, and all. In fact, a great swath of settlers bottled up on the Atlantic side of the Appalachian Mountains believed not that the British were too authoritative, but that they weren't authoritative enough. These pioneers would have seen little distinction between an ISIS beheading and an Iroquois scalping, and as the Indians, with cause, clutched desperately to their native lands, settlers were aghast that the British did not do more to protect them against such terrorism. British statesmen in 1775 did know they had a frisky colt on the end of the line, and had been debating for 50 years or better if and when the colonies would break free. America wasn't some contained, controllable sugar island. This was a vibrant, pounding, liquor-fueled mob of opportunists that was encouraged by dreams of fortunes to be had, especially if the prim British spoilsports could be forced to let go of the reins. Visionaries in Britain understood that to hold on to the colony would require a delicate, if not impossible, balancing act. Already, America had nearly 2 centuries of European presence under her belt and nurtured a population that, for the most part, had come to her shores because of one spite or another they held against the Old World. Once these colonists became economically and martially self-sufficient, Britain would cease to be anything beyond a bothersome bureaucracy in need of purging. So, to maintain the colonists' dependency on the motherland, the British tightened trade and police power, which ironically were the 2 things most likely to inspire colonists to seek their independence all the more. Out of this were born the cocked-hatted and buckle-shoed buzzwords with which we are all so familiar. Liberty, freedom and representation, pursuit of happiness, and natural rights of man. Every schoolchild knows that tyranny finally transgressed the bounds of what a reasonable man should have to endure, and we burst from an oppressive cocoon to follow the shining light of freedom. We celebrate all this, the birth of a great republic, today, as we should. But there is so much more to the story that is missed when we stop there. When history is sanitized and spit-polished in the name of creating a national creation story, many interesting people and stories are overlooked because they don't fit neatly into the narrative. The intention of this book is to add, at least to a small degree, some stories that have fallen out of the mainstream of literature about the Revolution, and perhaps contribute a greater understanding or context to the war in the process. It's not a collection of trivia, or in any way an effort to fill in any significant number of blanks. Its purpose is to be educational and fun, while demonstrating that there was a lot more to the Revolution than Washington crossing the Delaware. Very loosely, this book shadows the chronology of the Revolution proper, which effectively began with the conclusion of the French and Indian War, 1763, gained momentum through events that included increasing taxation, the Boston Massacre, 1770, and the Boston Tea Party, 1773, and then broke into open warfare that, greatly simplified, included the battles of Lexington and Concord April 1775, the capture of Fort Ticonderoga, May 1775, the Battle of Bunker Hill and the Siege of Boston, June 1775, Washington's defeat and withdrawal from New York, August 1776, the Battle of Trenton, December 1776, Burgoyne's surrender at Saratoga, and the entry of France into the war, October 1777, Howe's capture of Philadelphia and the winter at Valley Forge, 1777 and 78, the British capture of Charleston, South Carolina, and invasion of the South, 1780, and the British surrender at Yorktown, 1781. Finally, this book is told more from a storyteller's perspective than that of a seasoned historian. It goes without saying that 250-year-old events are often difficult, if not impossible, to verify. Historians correctly shy away from stories for which there is no proof. Yet many legends told over the years are equally impossible to disprove, and in reality are seldom entirely made up out of whole cloth. Yes, they will generally be improved upon with the retelling over the years, some to the point that they become a bit silly and categorically unbelievable. It's worth considering, though, that for every legend that didn't happen, there are a dozen more, far better stories that have been forgotten. The view here is that, for example, the Molly Pitcher legend, which wasn't firmed up until nearly a century after the war, is worth presenting, even if, in standard form, it's a bit too perfect. Molly Pitcher was the moniker awarded the loving wife who followed her husband into battle, took his place at the cannon when he fell, and carried water for parched patriots at the Battle of Monmouth. But it seems safe to say that if this legend didn't happen exactly as we've been told, something like it did. Molly Pitcher more likely is a composite of several women, including perhaps a profane, whiskey-swilling camp follower picturesquely known as Dirty Kate, who, shall we say, put a charge into a lot more than cannons and eventually died of syphilis. So, in the retelling, we have actually made the story somewhat more heroic and somewhat less interesting. The same might be said for the war itself. It is good that we preserve our idealized creation story. All nations do. It is from this that we draw pride and inspiration. But it is equally rewarding, and more entertaining, when we dig a little deeper beneath the surface. Chapter 1. The War That Started It All. On July 26, 1764, a year after the conclusion of the French and Indian War, and just over a decade before the first shot of the American Revolution was heard the world around, a young teacher named Enoch Brown rang the bell in a one-room schoolhouse where he taught the children of Scots-Irish farmers in south-central Pennsylvania. The school was near the present-day town of Mercersburg, in a broad, fertile valley flanked by long, sleepy blue ridges. On this summer day, Brown wasn't attracting as many takers as usual, but two girls and nine boys grudgingly straggled into the school and took their seats. Brown had barely started the lesson when he heard a commotion and looked up to see four Delaware Indians rushing the door. Having lived on the American frontier long enough to know what was about to happen, Brown dropped to his knees and begged the braves to kill him and spare the children. The Indians accommodated his first wish, but not the second. Several hours later, a passerby discovered the bodies of the teacher and 10 children, all of whom had been tomahawked and scalped. The 11th child, a boy, survived the scalping, and although he lived into old age, he was never right, and he was a walking reminder of grudges long held. 19th-century historian Francis Parkman called the tragedy an outrage unmatched in fiendish atrocity through all the annals of the war. The war he spoke of was not the Revolution, but the French and Indian War, or Seven Years' War, as it was known in Europe. It was, in retrospect, the kindling that lit the revolutionary fires, having been fought between the years of 1754 and 1763, ending a scant 6 years before the Boston Massacre. This explosive world war, which would spread to 3 continents, was started by none other than George Washington. Apologists stress that he was only trying to help, who was sent to the frontier by Virginia Governor Robert Dinwiddie to look out for British interests. The British were pushing into the Midwest, present-day Ohio and western Pennsylvania, from the east and south, while the French were pushing into the same territory from the north and west. The Indians were squeezed from both sides, but they sided with the French because the French treated them with respect, while the British treated them like dirt. In the summer of 1754, Washington's men ambushed and killed a dozen Frenchmen that they really shouldn't have, and provoked a French attack that led to Washington's surrender, the only time in the great general's history that he would do so. Washington and his men stoically limped back to Virginia, taunted and robbed by the Indians for much of the way. The British and colonial Americans, though losing the battle, would win the war. The French were humiliated the world around, an embarrassment they would not soon forget. And while the British had now rousted the French out of North America, they were not gracious in victory, spreading seeds of discontent among enemy and friend alike. Galling as the Enoch Brown massacre was, settlers soon had reason to be outraged with the British army as well, a force that was supposed to be protecting them from Indian attack, residual hostilities of the 7 Years' War. Tension between the settlers and the government already existed in the Mid-Atlantic, following the Royal Proclamation Line of 1763, an arbitrary line on a map that largely prevented settlement in the western lands just taken from the French. Colonial militia, which included plenty of frontier settlers, had helped win the war, and now they were being told that they were not entitled to the spoils. For the Scots-Irish, this smelled a lot like the land overbearance that had driven them away from the old sod to begin with. Worse, when Pennsylvania lifted a trade ban following the cessation of hostilities, the settlers learned that British-sanctioned merchants were sending contraband to the Indians, including rum, gunpowder, and even scalping knives. This was an element of free enterprise that was understandably hard for the frontier pioneers, who were attached to their scalps in more ways than one, to appreciate. At the heart of the controversy in south-central Pennsylvania was an Irish-born merchant, land speculator, and Indian agent named George Croghan, who arrived in the colonies in 1741. Where many settlers saw only brutal Native American savages, Croghan saw economic opportunity. He began his commercial life as a fur trader, and soon was opening up something like a chain of frontier convenience stores at Indian villages, which undercut the British megamarts that the Redcoats had erected for their own utility on major wagon roads. Where the British and the settlers disdained and feared the Indians, the canny Croghan learned their languages and customs, including the routine of gift-giving, which, as customs go, was the Native American version of basic hospitality. Croghan lost his shirt during the French and Indian War, when trade with the enemy was prohibited. Even after the war, Indians continued to take out their frustrations over decades of poor treatment at the hands of the Europeans by streaking down the Appalachian Mountains and laying waste to random farms and settlements from Maine to the Carolinas. Hundreds of settlers in lonely hills and hollows on the eastern edge of the mountains were killed or kidnapped. A farmer looking up from his plow to see a column of smoke over the next ridge would feel a bolt of terror, knowing that the Indians had just killed his neighbors, and he would likely be next. While the Indian response was brutal, it was not without provocation. Waves of Scots-Irish escaping the tyranny of the Old World had heedlessly spilled across boundary lines established by treaties, lines that had been unfairly drawn in the Europeans' favor to begin with. The Indian tribes of the Northeast were surprised and offended at the uncouth immigrants from the British Isles, and as they regrouped in the Ohio territories, they correctly predicted that the Appalachian Mountains in the end would not be enough to stop the white settlers' encroachment. After the surrender of the French, the Indians gave it one last try in 1763 under the leadership of an Ottawan chief named Pontiac. The uprising was rather quickly snuffed out, but not before the four Delaware braves paid a visit to Enoch Brown's school. When the dust settled from Pontiac's war, George Croghan was anxious to earn back some of the profits he'd lost during the hostilities, and he wasn't terribly sympathetic to the settlers who had interrupted his commerce. Or, at least, he felt no qualms selling liquor and weapons, what could go wrong, to the still-stewing Indians. The Mercersburg settlements, which would include the birthplace of future President James Buchanan, cried foul and petitioned the British authorities to stop the illegal trade. The British, however, were still testy that, while other colonies raised militia to help fight the war, the pacifist Quakers entrenched in the Pennsylvania Assembly had refused, nor were they particularly excited about helping the Scots-Irish, who were in America to begin with to escape His Majesty's rule. Further, Croghan had cut a deal with British General Thomas Gage to patch things up with the Indians west of the Appalachians. The trader would take a wagon train over the mountains, laden with gifts for the Indians in the Ohio and Illinois territories, greasing some palms and laying the groundwork for British occupation in the west. What Croghan neglected to mention to the general was that the bulk of his wagon train would be stuffed with private goods that he intended to trade to the Indians for furs at a significant profit for himself. In the mountains, there is a saying that to escape notice, fat possums travel at night. Croghan's mule train, 81 animals strong, was a classic fat possum. It would do no good to let the British see his expansive convoy, which obviously packed in a lot more goods than the ceremonial presents that it was authorized to convey. So Robert Callender, a partner of Croghan, who was leading the expedition on March 5, 1765, ducked British authorities by avoiding the main wagon road to Pittsburgh. Instead, he stuck to local trails and deer paths. This sleight of hand might have fooled the British, but the settlers immediately smelled a rat. They tried to reason with Callender, arguing that they themselves would likely be the victims of the incendiary products that Croghan was sending into the arms of their enemies. Callender did not consider this to be his problem. His ample train ignored the pioneers' pleas and continued its journey west to the foot of a 2,000-foot-long ridge known as Sidling Hill. Suddenly, a dozen frontier farmers stepped into the path, their faces painted black, in a fashion that today would probably strike us as more comical than fierce. But Callender did not find the situation humorous, and readily complied when settlers demanded he and his men unload the horses and place the goods in a pile. The Black Boys, as they came to be known, picked through the goods, taking what was considered useful and burning the rest. Where Callender had avoided the British regulars before, he now sought them out. He and his men hightailed to the 9-year-old Fort Loudon, an unconvincing stronghold that for some reason had been constructed in a depression along the Forbes Road to western Pennsylvania. Ironically, it was this outpost that Callender had probably been trying to avoid in the first place, much as an overloaded trucker seeks to dodge interstate scales. Now, however, Callender burst into the fort and reported the atrocity on Sidling Hill to the Fort Loudon commander, Lieutenant Charles Grant, a well-meaning young man who was a week shy of his 25th birthday. Grant's company was tasked with ensuring that the colonial settlers stayed on their own side of the Allegheny Mountains and did not cross over into Indian territory. This would put the British detachment somewhat at odds with the pioneers, who were disinclined to stay put. There was one other card in play, which would have worked in the traders' favor over the settlers. Grant had been taken prisoner by the Wyandot Indians near Detroit 5 years prior, and his release had been secured by none other than George Croghan. Grant sent a detachment of soldiers to the scene of the crime, where they found some of the black boys lounging around in blankets that had probably been rescued from the ensuing bonfire. The British Highlanders chased the black boys into the woods, managing to catch two of them. Hustling their captives back to the fort, the soldiers were suddenly blindsided by 50 rifle-brandishing black boys who demanded the prisoners be released. The Highlanders' leader was in no mood to be bullied by a group of frontier ruffians, and his men grabbed 4 more prisoners, as the black boys, not quite ready to take hostilities to the next level, scattered into the forest. 3 days later, however, they were back, occupying the high ground overlooking the rickety Fort Loudoun. Grant barred the doors, manned the shooting decks, and sent out a messenger demanding to know who would have the audacity to menace the King's Fort. James Smith, a respected settler who in a past life had spent a considerable amount of time as a captive of the Indians and was the black boy's leader, stepped forward and demanded that the redcoats release his men. If the British refused, the colonial settlers were prepared to fight and die for their cause. Grant hesitated. A firefight was risky, since he was significantly outnumbered and the fort was not terribly secure. But a representative of the crown could hardly submit to rabble. The precedent and embarrassment were too terrible to think about. Grant attempted to gather reinforcements by sending messengers to Fort Bedford, 40 miles to the west. But the black boys captured one messenger after another, until Smith had more prisoners than Grant. Both sides were somewhat flummoxed until Callender solved the standoff by offering to post bail for the colonial prisoners, whom Grant then released. But he kept their guns. This proved an unwise move, because on the frontier at that point in time, the muskets might have been somewhat more valued than the men pulling the trigger. The black boys would eventually return for the weapons, and if it meant attacking an official British fort to get them, then that's exactly what they'd do. Back in Philadelphia, word of the uprising against the crown created no small amount of consternation. Croghan had acted illegally, it was true, but the settlers had directly flaunted British authority. In a case such as this, where the issue was difficult to sort out, the government fell back on what it did best. Nothing. Meanwhile, wealthy capitalists, and people hoping to become wealthy capitalists, were angry over the proclamation line as well, for reasons that weren't all that different from the farmers. While not amused by the thought of armed, lawless clodhoppers on the frontier burning loads of freight, in the end, they also wanted the newly won English lands to be open to trade and speculation. This was an important moment in the history of the American Revolution. For perhaps the first time, everyone in colonial America, rich and poor, urban and rural, wanted the same thing, the spoils of the French and Indian War. And it was the king who was standing in the way. Historian David Dixon wrote, "British officials could not know when they first concocted the proclamation line that the measure would help to make colonial America a crucible in which resentful and defiant social strata would come together. Within this cauldron of discontent can be found the ingredients for revolutionary agitation." The only thing lacking for an all-out rebellion at the moment was gunfire. It wouldn't be lacking for long. The aggrieved settlers took Philadelphia's indecision as license to establish their own highway patrol, notifying convoy drivers hauling goods to the west that their loads were subject to inspection and required a pass from the local magistrate. Those who failed to obtain a pass were roughed up, even if they were legitimately hauling goods to restock military forts. On May 6, 1765, The uncooperative crew of a packhorse train was bound and beaten near a residence picturesquely known as Widow Barr's place. This time, Lieutenant Grant sent soldiers out from the fort to confront the black boys, and the two sides set pleasantries aside and actually began firing their weapons at each other, somewhat ineffectively, as the only injury was suffered by a settler named James Brown, who was shot in the leg. This tentative fighting continued through the summer and fall until the black boys, who couldn't stop thinking about those guns that Grant had refused to return, brought a force 300 strong to attack Fort Loudoun. Badly outnumbered, Grant gave back the 8 rifles in question, and shortly afterward the British regulars gave up their fight against the black boys and abandoned the fort. The black boys' rebellion is seldom remarked upon today, probably because it produced only the 1 minor casualty. But for 9 months the two sides had slung lead at each other, even if the results had been unimpressive. In fact, it would seem that the safest place to be in all of colonial America at the time was standing in opposition to the enemy's guns. However, the action was still significant because at no point in the skirmishes would the black boys or the British regulators have considered themselves to be safe from harm. Both sides were serious. At one point, Lieutenant Grant, out for a walk, was captured by the black boys and tied to a tree. Had any one of the black boys impulsively swung a rifle butt or pulled a trigger, and they had certainly made threats that they were willing to do so, the British Army likely would have fallen on the black boys in force, and a full-fledged war would have broken out. At this particular time, some of the more egregious British tax policies had yet to be introduced, so the colonies as a whole weren't the tinderbox they would become in 1775. But the Pennsylvania colonists felt just as aggrieved as the Massachusetts colonists did at Lexington and Concord 10 years hence. As it was, some historians are loath to even call the black boys' action a rebellion, because the settlers basically just wanted the British to enforce the law. But Lieutenant Grant referred to it as a rebellion, and the black boys' leader James Smith considered himself and his men to be rebels. Perhaps both were overstating things. The black boys, after all, didn't want to throw off the yoke of government. They wanted the government to do its job. Still, it's difficult to conclude that the settlers were not at root rebelling against British authority. If issuing commercial permits, seizing and destroying property, and shooting against a standing army was not a rebellion, it was doing a relatively credible impression of one. Nor was the black boys' rebellion entirely unique. There were at least a half dozen other uprisings against authority in the century before Lexington and Concord, where colonists resorted to violence. In 1676, Bacon's Rebellion broke out when Nathaniel Bacon led several hundred Virginians against the unpopular colonial governor William Barclay, whom they viewed as too conciliatory toward the Native Americans. The mob chased Barclay out of the capital and burned Jamestown to the ground. Things might have gotten interesting except for the untimely death of Bacon a month later. Without the charismatic Bacon to gin them up, literally and figuratively, the rebels quickly lost interest in the face of governmental pushback. A year before the Black Boys' Rebellion, the Paxton Boys, a militia of maybe 250 Scots-Irish settlers organized by the Reverend John Elder, parson of a church in Paxtang, Pennsylvania, marched on Philadelphia, demanding revenge against the Indians for raids conducted during Pontiac's War. The angry mob was talked off the ledge by a group of city fathers, including a man by the name of Ben Franklin. In the long view of history, however, these events seem less like rebellions than psychotic episodes. Bacon, charitably described by historians as complex, and Barclay had a florid hatred of each other that drove the violence. At one point, Bacon and his men leveled their...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.